This programme is brought to you by UCKG.
Welcome to another unique episode of A Different Kind of Woman. A different kind of woman never compares herself to others. The internet is the social home of networks, to tweets of our random thoughts, post pictures of our lunch, funny videos, cute animal pictures, and blogs. So on today's show, Meet the Bloggers, we are going to be discussing the positive and negative influencing powers of social media. Let's take a look on what's coming up on today's show. Next, we're going to find out what people on the streets of London think with Anna Maria.
They need to be listening to what people are saying out there, and that's what is important with social media. You can't stop it, it's an unstoppable beast.
Hear from successful bloggers at the Blog Awards.
In this day and age, being a daddy blogger, being a known commentator on parenting and fatherhood issues is actually a really important thing. So, and I think having this award in Brelia will mean that bit more. It will mean actually the opinions that I express on behalf of other fathers.
And we'll be welcoming social media expert Maria Tuckers to our studio.
So it's not about the social media per se. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's about the message, you know, the message, one message. And social media gives you cheap traffic.
I'm not discussing this topic alone. Joining me is the gorgeous Gemma.
Oh, thanks. Hi.
And back in the studio with us is our elegant Verena. Welcome back.
Hello, it's great to have you.
And we also have the adorable Anne.
Adorable, thank you.
You've never been called that before.
No, never.
On today's show, Meet the Bloggers, we're going to be discussing the positive and negative influences of social media. So firstly, ladies, let me ask you, what do you think makes social media trend?
What makes a social media trend? I guess something that's getting tongues going, that's getting people talking, something that's relevant at any period of time, something that people are interested in.
Yeah, a lot of the times it's what celebrities are doing. So they will, you know, come up with a new word, or it could be, you know, they're endorsing a certain product. Sometimes it's a lot of the time for women, especially, it's about beauty. Mm. And, you know, so if like a celebrity does it and they've got a really massive social media presence, they'll use certain hashtags, which are really, really important on social media. And that's what will make it trend. And of course, anything controversial.
Yeah.
Miss V?
She's just taking it all in.
And I also think it's like, you know, sometimes there's this new dance craze that also gets things trending.
Yeah,
as well and
yeah, like the mannequin challenge.
Yeah.
Like
that. Oh, gosh, so popular. But before we do delve in further into the show, let's find out what the people in the streets of London thought with Anna Maria.
What do you think are the positive and negative effects of social media?
Well, I think social media is amazing at connecting people, and particularly around interests and around issues. So, you know, you've actually seen some really positive effects come about. I think that as a result of that, I think you also got negative issues with the fact that people with malign intents are also using it to come together as well.
Well, I think the negative effects of social media is that it's all cyberbullying. However, the positive effects are you can find out public transport, you can find out other local information that you need.
It depends how it's used. I think social media can be very negative for a lot of people.
In what?
In terms of mental health, a lot of people spend a lot of time focused on their phones and Facebook and not really interacting with people, and you kind of can sort of lead to depression and things like that. But the other side, social media is perfect for business, self-employed people, self-promotion, things like that.
Social media really is something that's been ahead of the game with broadcasters for a number of years now, and broadcasters slowly catching up with it. And I think now broadcasters realise they need to be listening to social media a lot more to find out what people are saying about anything, about a particular politician or a football player or a football team or a particular topic, what's happened with Brexit, you know, happening with Trump in America. They need to be listening to what people are saying out there. And that's what is important with social media. You can't stop it. It's an unstoppable beast.
I'd say the positives are that it's accessible for everyone. So you don't have to pay to use it, things like that. You get a really honest opinion on social media. Negatives are that it's easier to troll, I suppose, on social media. And the fact that it's accessible to all can sometimes be a negative as well, in the sense that it can't be monitored or controlled as easy.
And how much of blogging do you think is advertising?
I feel like a lot. Like whenever I'm online and there's blogs, there's always tons of advertising on there. But I feel like that's what you kind of sign up for when you go on blogs and things like that.
A lot. Everything is on social media. You can find everything out on social media more than what you can find anywhere else.
A lot of blogs I see are predominantly advertising, because all these bloggers are getting paid and sort of free things to promote products, so a lot of it's biased and there's not a lot of genuine opinion out there. A lot of these big businesses have an influence on it.
The social media is an avenue to do advertising. Twitter do it, Facebook do it, everybody does it. Once you put these platforms out there for the public, it is going to end up being used for commercial purposes as well. You can't avoid that. You can't escape it.
Something I'd say about that is that, you know, in traditional media, people draw a line between advertorial and editorial, and I think that's a really useful line to continue to draw in still in new media. I think it's really important to be transparent about what your motives for writing about something are.
Do you have any questions on this subject?
What are the best strategies people have found for dealing with abuse online, not letting their voice be taken away by aggressive people online?
Wow, they've said quite a bit there. So yeah. what would you say to the question that the gentleman asked? What are the effective ways and best ways to get rid of abuse? Because a lot of people feel abused on social media as well. So yeah. What are your thoughts?
You know, see, I don't really get a lot of abuse on my profile. Mm. I think I've got quite a nice profile. I think I've got quite a nice profile, you know, but I'm being biased. But sometimes people do complain. You know, I know people who complain about abuse and comments, and they delete them and block people and so on. And you are going to get that on a public sphere. But I feel that sometimes it depends on what you're putting out there. If you're going to put something out there which is controversial, then social media is not regulated and people are entitled to their opinion. So in as much as people say, wow, love your outfit, you look amazing, you're so pretty, you're wonderful and you're great.
Thanks.
You know, to adorable Anne here, you know, some people, if you put something out there which is supposed to be controversial, and this is my opinion and this is what I think, and you know it's controversial, people have a right, if your profile's public, especially if you're a public figure, to then give their opinion and say, or if your outfit doesn't look great, I'm sorry, that doesn't match, or that looks absolutely ridiculous. People have a right to do that because it's a public thing. So I think it's what you put out there a lot of the time is what you're going to get back. Some people, unfortunately, they do get trolls, and you know, you see a lot of celebrities, like, you know, you'll see people following them, and in the comments you'll see people just write, oh gosh, you're just plain ugly, and you know, look at your eyebrows, and you can see people are just tormenting them. But I think for people who are trying to be controversial or put a point out there or try to talk about something, you know, which is very current and they want opinions, you're going to get the good and the bad.
It's a similar situation as if you're actually getting into politics.
Right.
Because I was just listening to you. I'm from the older generation, and I was just listening to you, and I just think, gosh, this is a bit like being in politics, really, when you put yourself out there.
Yeah, and if you open your profiles, for example, on social media, on all platforms, you can close them. You can have them on the privacy mode that you choose. And if you decide, I want it to be public and I want it to be open, then you're opening yourself up to that. That's my opinion.
That's so true. And I think it's very unfortunate, though, because like a lot of people on the street said, it's such a positive thing. But with anything that's positive, you're always going to get those that abuse it and take the mick. And especially if you are a celebrity, or if, or even if you're not, if someone feels that they have an opinion, they are free to share it. And there's no monitoring as to whether, okay, let's see if this opinion is going to hurt the person's feeling or not. And so I don't even know if there is any strategy as such to avoid something like that, which is unfortunate. But I guess if you choose to use social media, you're just going to have to accept that it comes with the good and the bad, unfortunately.
I guess it does, because there's some people, they just want to be accepted, so they will put up that picture because they want to hear the good comments. But with it, you know, they want opinions, it gives them that kind of confidence. But again, as you all said, with the good comes the bad.
Make it to be accepted, don't put that picture up.
I'm telling you. So for decades, hashtag symbols was commonly referred to as the pound sign. In recent years, this ordinary symbol evolved into greater significance in a modern world, slowly but surely being dominated by social media, tagging keywords, phrases, and other strings of text and letters are what social media users do to track topics and conversations. Twitter were the first to use the hashtag, where it's still prevalent, although it took some time for Facebook to jump on the craze, following by other social networks such as Pinterest, Instagram, etc. Hashtag has also been known to help businesses with insights on what targeted customers are interested in and what they are most talking about. So basically, whatever's happening in the world, social media hashtags will let you know within seconds. So ladies, what do you think were the top hashtags of 2016? Let's see if you know.
I don't have a clue.
Yeah. If you're on Instagram and Twitter, you would know.
I am.
I'm on Instagram, but
Facebook.
All right, let me help them out a bit. I think some of the top ones were like love.
Love is a big one.
People like to talk about love. They sing about love. So love, I think follow, selfie, anything about like, me, hashtag me.
Makeup, probably.
Yeah, makeup, beauty.
Like for like.
Yeah. And on, I know that on Instagram, a lot of Insta stuff, so like Insta travel, Insta beauty, Instagram.
But as hashtags as well.
Yeah, they're all hashtags. Pick of the day, photo of the day. So those things... These two are making me laugh. Yeah. And the good thing about the hashtag is you can see what's trending really easily. Yeah. And if you're interested in a topic, like for example, when I was getting married, I would look at weddings or weddings in London, and that would be the hashtag. And you can see all the weddings, or you can see wedding cakes if you put in a hashtag. So it's really good to see what people are.
The thing is, it's so generic though, isn't it? Like hashtag love. All right. What on earth are you going to find? It's such a broad topic.
I know, but then if you've got
something specific.
No, but for example, if you've got a picture of, say, you and your husband getting married, or you and your husband, which is really creative, or you and your partner, whatever, and you hashtag it love, someone could look at that and think, oh, that's really nice. Or maybe it could be a story, and then it could link back to your blog. Or if your business is about love, Valentine's.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a fan of the hashtag. Well, yeah. I am definitely a fan of a hashtag, but I like it when it's a bit more specific.
Yeah,
I think it just
people get lost with it, because some people are like, hashtag, I'm not going to do this, to be honest. Yeah.
It gets quite
long. And it's so long.
Yeah,
and
I'm
then
a
when
fan
you
of a long hashtag.
Posted, it's only one person that's posted about it, and so no one's going to be following that hashtag. So basically, the hashtag doesn't matter anymore.
Well, let's take a look at the results, because there's a results plasma TV is going to show us.
Maybe some celebrity names might be there.
Well, let's have a look.
Maybe Donald Trump might be there.
Brexit. Well, let's take a look.
Oh,
Rio. See, I wouldn't have imagined Rio.
Brexit. Black Lives Matter. Oh, look, us two that don't know much about...
Those two that didn't know much more. Black Lives Matter.
Oscars, Euro...
Trump.
Pokemon Go, I didn't know. Oh, yeah.
Pokemon Trump. Go was big.
Oh,
and I
yeah, Black Lives Matter. Yeah, that makes sense.
It's a shame that number nine's up there, RIP.
We did have a lot of celebrity deaths, didn't we, in 2016, unfortunately.
Yeah. But look, for example, look, Game of Thrones is up there to show just how popular a show it is, a TV show, so that's actually really good. Wow, that's amazing. Wow.
I never knew.
So well done, guys. You've got loads of them.
I know. Clearly, we're using social media in the right way and our hashtags. So.
I guess so. Well, ladies, we're going to take a short break, but don't go away as we'll be back soon with more exciting discussions. Welcome back. Today we're talking blogging in our Meet the Bloggers episode. According to a YouGov survey commissioned by the Prince's Trust, 34% of 16 to 25-year-olds in the UK say they have felt depressed as a direct result of something they have viewed on social networking websites. The poll also revealed that 39% of adults, young adults, that is, are friends with people online that they have never met before. More than one in seven, 14%, young Brits also admit that they have been bullied online, with 20% saying that they have witnessed more bullying online than in person. 16 to 18-year-olds are the most likely to have been victims of cyberbullying and have seen more bullying over the internet than in real life. However, there are also people who have found positive and encouraging things on social media. So, ladies, let me ask you this question. Do you think blogging or social media in general is good or bad for you?
It's like with everything in life. You know, you can get some good out of it and some bad. And it all depends to your intention in the first place, being on there. If you wanted to be something that's positive, then you can create something positive out of it. You know, if you want negativity out of it, then that's what you'll get. You know, it all depends.
That's interesting, yeah, because I think if you're not on social media for, you know, to make an impact, so to speak, like for your own business or what have you, and you can decide then to have your own network. Like, I know, Verena, you've got that. And I think everybody on your network is pretty much people that you've worked with, that you grew up with. That it's people that you know. So you wouldn't necessarily be bullied by those people because you know
exactly.
them. What I find interesting is that a lot of people don't know the people that they're befriending. And I'm one of those people that I've got, like, I think on my Facebook alone, I might have maybe 2,000 friends or something. I don't know them all. A lot of them are from other countries, but that's because of the work that I do, like this television show. I've written loads of stuff. So I've come across people. And I think if there is anybody that would become abusive, I wouldn't let it get to the point of them bullying me. I would probably just delete them or, you know, if they... But you know, the other side of it is, I go back to my other point, and it's difficult when you're younger as well to sort of make this sound judgment. But I would delete or block them, or I would allow people to have their point of view, because sometimes what people are putting out on there, like you said, Verena, is about intentions. Like, what is your intention? So if you're going to put out something that's going to cause a stir, or, you know, something that you want the likes or the
comments. Detrimental to somebody else.
Detrimental to someone else, and you want comments and you want feedback, which is what you want on social media. You want feedback. You know, you can't live in this bubble where you're going to expect that all the feedback is going to be positive. So am I condoning bullying or, you know, trying to hurt people or put people down? No. But, you know, it depends on your intentions for your social media as well. Because a lot of the time what your intentions are, you'll get back within feedback, if you know what I mean. Mm. And there are some really terrible people out there, but it's how you use your social media as well, you've got to take responsibility for, I think.
I think, you know, one of the big problems actually with social... Not problems, it's a positive thing overall, I think. But one of the issues there is that everything is magnified. Mm-hmm. And for example, a person, I thought the statistics were quite shocking actually, the bullying, 34% young adults. So there might be someone that perhaps would be bullied, perhaps because of the way they look, etc., face to face. That might be one, I don't know, a few people may bully them. But on social media, they're open up to everyone. Mm. And it's actually not just your friends. Yeah. If I like something, you know, in some cases, someone else can see that and then comments can start from there. Mm. And I think it's also sad at the same time that perhaps someone can't enjoy the benefits of social media unless they are bullied. And I know, you know, I hope I don't sound like I'm contradicting what I said in the beginning. I know that it's free for all. Everyone, you know, is able to say what they want, to express themselves, etc. But it is also sad at the same time, because here I am just posting a picture to a few friends and someone decides to make a snipe comment, or a few people decide to make a snipe comment.
So who are your friends then?
Well, it could be a friend of a friend that has made that comment.
Then you can close it so that only your friends see it, for instance.
You may close it, but the effect is still there.
Yeah.
If I'm walking on the street, someone says something about me, it's going to hurt to me. But if it's on social media, a few people have seen it. I may unfriend them, unfollow them or whatever.
But you've suffered the impact.
So it is hurtful. Whoever you are, it's hurtful.
Definitely.
Yeah. It's only for the brave, I guess.
Yeah, it's true.
There are people that don't post controversial things or things to get people to, you know, be mean to them. There are people that just want to generally post something nice and then they get these, you know, really... you know, harsh comments.
But let's be real. We've all seen a picture where we've said to our friend, oh my gosh, have you seen that person's hair?
But
we would never write it.
Exactly.
But there are people that will.
Yeah.
And that's the problem.
The thing is, I think on social media is that people feel a little bit more empowered. So in the same way that you feel empowered to put on your selfie, you know, like, let's face it, are we going to turn up to work or in our workplace like, you know...
Well, I definitely...
You see all of this on social media.
Yeah.
You're not going to be doing that at your desk. The regular person's not. And you know the thing about... The other thing is, sometimes I see people all Snapchat filtered out and I think they look amazing. And then when you do see them in real life, you're like, wow! That's what causes me.
To then
screenshot it to my friends like, wow, she looks completely different.
Yeah.
I'm being honest.
So
I do
you
do
say
it.
Then is social media is empowering them?
Yes.
Would you agree?
Well, yeah, I agree.
I agree.
You know the thing about social media.
I've seen some people who are wallflowers.
Yeah.
And then if you look at their Facebook page, they are there.
Yeah,
you
know? Like,
but when you meet them in person, they can't even say hello. Say hello.
Yeah,
they're all meek and humble. So, it's just unbelievable.
So in the same way they're empowered to do what they do on social media, people feel empowered to almost be in secret and to be like, actually, you're ugly.
But that's the point.
I hate those eyebrows. Because the thing is, you feel empowered on social media.
Yeah, you do.
It's everybody's platform. I mean, you know, we know about a few cases where do you want to say where women have actually, well, I know for myself, my son is quite handsome,
and
a few years ago he was quite slim, and people would basically approach him and ask him to model because he was very good looking at the time. And somebody had stolen his profile on Facebook.
Wow. Yeah, and renamed it something different.
And renamed it something different, you know. And apparently this is very, very common where people are stealing other people's profiles. And it could be a 70, 80-year-old man, but he's got a profile of a young man, handsome young man. It could be some ugly old man.
Yeah.
And he's got a very handsome profile there.
Yeah.
And with that, he's attracting women.
Yeah. And that's where the dangers come in, because if we're talking about, say, the 16 to 24-year-olds, people who are maybe more vulnerable and a little bit more naive, you know, people forget, I think, on social media that you're putting everything out there.
Mm.
And once it goes out there, you will never, like you said, and you will never get it back.
Mm-hmm.
And I think some of the dangers, if we're talking about the negatives, would be that some people post a little bit too much. So, you know, we're putting all of our houses on there. Sometimes we're putting our location. Sometimes we're putting where we go to school.
Yeah.
And if someone really wanted to follow you and have malicious intent, like, say, even a paedophile, for instance, that person can easily learn
or easily
find where you go.
I'll hold you ladies
on that
for the second segment. We're going to take a short break. But before we go, let's meet the bloggers of the 2016 Blog Awards in this video.
It's an amazing vibe in here. It's so noisy, but I'm really excited to be here. I want to see who wins. There's some fantastic awards up. It's always good to recognise people's achievements, and especially to reward people that when they've worked so hard. So to come together and kind of see all these people here, it's a really nice feeling to a community.
I used to be a journalist, and I can see just how important
blogging is now. It is the mainstream media, as far as I'm concerned. So these awards recognise that. It's only the second year, but I think Wellio has really established itself as the main media database and the only one that follows the blogging scene. There are some really good bloggers here on all categories, so to make it onto the shortlists, it's amazing.
It's really nice. I was really excited for a month. I'm nominated with like really great bloggers that I've been like following before I even started blogging. So it's really good feeling that after some time of work you actually get like recognized, and it's really good.
What a vibrant evening it is tonight to see so many hundreds of people out here celebrating the great work that goes on online, which well deserved all round.
It's great to be here. When I got the invite, we were really excited, and we work quite closely with bloggers, so travel bloggers, beauty bloggers as well, Duty Free in our shop. We want to work more and more with bloggers in the future, so I think tonight I've got my business cards ready and waiting, so I'll definitely be networking, making some contacts, and hopefully we can work with them up at Birmingham Airport.
Amazing. I've never won anything. I've been shortlisted a few times, but it's just amazing to actually win, especially up against some amazing competition, some amazing girls that I'm lucky to be friends with.
I'm completely stunned. I honestly speechless. It's always thrilling to be recognised for what you've done. Blogging can be quite a lonely job. You do it on your own a lot of the time, and it's fantastic to know that people are reading it and enjoying it.
This is my first Wellio event, so I'm actually glad to come and see what it's all about. For me, I mean, we meet so many people digitally, whether it be Twitter or through our blog or Facebook or just online in general. And me, I'm all about face-to-face communication, so it's really nice to actually meet people for the first time in the flesh.
It's always good to get recognition, especially when it's judged by a panel of industry experts.
It's smashing. If it's possible to be better than last year, it is. Wonderful food, great company, lots of new people to meet. It's just great bloggers to come together like this.
Amazing. I mean, I was up against some really, really great bloggers, so it's fantastic to be the winner.
It's nice to get recognised for our interaction with our readers, and it's nice when things like books are appreciated by other people, so it's nice to get an award.
I came last year and it was such an amazing experience. I just felt like I had to come this year. I'm actually interested to see how people progress on their blogs and all the backstories they have on how they've progressed, how they've actually got where they are and what they're blogging about. It's nice to see what people are actually interested in and have a passion for.
In this day and age, being a daddy blogger, being a known commentator on parenting and fatherhood issues is actually a really important thing. So, and I think having this award from Wellio will mean that bit more. It will mean actually the opinions that I express on behalf of other fathers means that bit more.
I think blogging is here to stay, and I think we're getting better at it. And I think blogs are really being taken seriously as a medium in this country, and I think that's fantastic and really important.
Welcome back on today's show, Meet the Bloggers. We've been discussing the positive and negative effects of social media. Joining us in the studio today is social media marketing expert, Maria Tokas. Welcome, Maria. So, Maria, tell us, what inspired you to transition from a fashion designer to a marketing expert?
Well, that's an interesting story because the fashion brand that I run was conceived 100% virtual. So it's from the start, it was online business. Mm-hmm. So I did a show in Temple Hall, and I've recorded a video, a catwalk show, mm-hmm. and I put it on YouTube, and we promoted it very widely to laser targeted audiences, and I sold out the collection. Oh, wow. I understood that the power of social media and mm-hmm. actually the power of self-branding and self-publishing is so immense. And we just rocked on from that on, and digital marketing is just a level to increase your ambitions the way and to grow your business, literally, yeah.
So in layman's terms, what does Inonexima Media do?
So we help you to successfully create and run online business. Mm-hmm. So we say like internet is occupied by three types of people. So the first type is people who don't know what they're doing, clients. The second one is the people who take other people's money to learn how stuff works. This is agencies. And there are other ninja type and black belt type of people who are actually doing amazing things, and like they are running very successful businesses. Mm. So, but they either teach you how to do it or they just hide everything. So we are the third type of people because my team is actually formed of very successful internet entrepreneurs, and we run our kind of independent things on internet, and then we help people who are going to form their online business to do it very successfully.
Yeah. So why do you think having an online presence for a company is so important nowadays?
It's not even important. It's already like all the statistic goes that people spend 3 to 4 hours online. Mm. You know, then 1 hour of actually every person, the stats show that 1 hour they spend watching YouTube video a week. You know, and then we have like every second transactions on the earth itself is conceived online. So basically, we're talking. Wow. You know, 70% of videos are going to be conceived as a content in 2017. So if you're not online, you're missing out the opportunity. Yeah. And online actually helps explosive growth as well, because all the disruptive businesses, all the businesses that made it, you know, very quickly and very successfully. For instance, there is a Cambridge Shell company. Mm. The woman was doing bags just at home, you know, a mom sitting there.
I'm fascinated
there.
By her story.
Yeah, and the influencer outreach, she contacted the blogger, you know, the blogger wrote, boom, three factories, you know, just like that in under 6 months. And then another story, very successful. There is a Dollar's Shave Club. So they have like a $1 and a razor. Yeah, they put their very viral YouTube video, amazing, 20 million, boom. They have a $1 billion company in again, you know. Yeah. It's like very rapid kind of time span. So yeah, if you're a really ambitious business, yeah, and if you have limited budget, online gives you so much many opportunities to just to make it.
Yeah. Wow, we're about to open a business, so I'm just taking tips from you right now.
Yeah.
So how hard do you have to work in terms of making a video and promoting it?
Okay, so my job as a CEO is actually to make sure that we don't work hard, but we work smart. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because it really depends on the objectives and what you're trying to achieve. Yeah. So for instance, we've chosen YouTube because YouTube is the second largest search engine. You know, you get a lot of free traffic, and video is the most important. It's actually, you can emotionally connect with people. Yeah. You know, clients who come to me, they already know you, know me. You know, they saw my videos, they saw the personality. So I'm actually skipping this step of actually introducing myself. Mm-hmm. So in order to produce the video like that, you need to have the kind of creative compound, which is like actually doing the editing, which is a few days of work, yeah? And then you have to actually segment it in order to get the visibility online. So you actually start seeding it. And people who think, okay, I'm gonna upload the video on YouTube and it's gonna get viral like that, it's like 60% of the people of the YouTube videos, they get under 100 views. You know, and we on my channel it's 2.5 million now, and we're growing
so,
very
fast.
So
what makes you stand out then?
Oh, because it's very easy. You produce quality content, and then you actually get eyeballs, laser targeted eyeballs on this quality content. Yeah, very easy. Two compounds. Yeah, but for actually getting laser targeted audiences to see your video, you need to have to do a lot of competitive intelligence in terms of you need to research where these tribes are. You know, then you're going there and saying, "Oh, this is my new video," or giving them value. Yeah, because if you start selling them, no one is going to kind of buy because it's like too pushy, yeah? So first you need to create this content that is already suited for the audiences, you know? It gives the value, it triggers, it inspires, yeah? Once you deliver that content, then you go and select the channels that you want to promote. So the YouTube is one, yeah? Then Facebook is massive, another one. Then you have like your website, which is another one. So it's a consistent story, which is actually makes sense. So it's not about the social media per se, yeah? Mm-hmm. It's about the message, you know? Yeah. The message, one message. And social media gives you cheap traffic. So actually, if you, it's like if you are to hire a PR company, how much is that, you know? Like $5,000 a month, yeah? Mm-hmm. With social media, we're talking one people engagement, 1p. It means like you can reach thousands and thousands of people for a cup of Starbucks coffee, you know?
It's a no-brainer, really, isn't it?
Really, yeah, if you know what you're doing.
Yeah. But what would you say to those people that perhaps are social media novices and they know that there's a lot of opportunity perhaps hearing you today, but they perhaps that doesn't seem to be their world, so they're still stuck in old type of marketing. How can they, you know, what can they do as a first step to move their business forward on the online platform?
That's a great question because a lot of tools at the moment, they're very human friendly, you know, all the user interface and a lot of effort of all these techie guys actually goes in humiliating the technology, yeah? So it actually is this, you know, it's imperfect action is always better than perfect inaction. Mm. Meaning you just go and sit there and start figuring out stuff. Yeah. This is how you learn, you know? It's anything to do with, it's just about getting, you know, to overcoming this barrier, yeah. You know, a lot of people, it's not even old people. I am bombarded with so much of actually information that comes on there because internet, that's a good, another point, changes every 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Every 3 weeks, everything, you know, not everything, but all the trends, you know, all these transitions, they change, yeah? So you need to be constantly kind of learning. So you just go into this mentality that, you know, I'm going to make it, yeah? Little by little, step by step, you encourage yourself and then you learn it. And this is how you progress. Mm-hmm. Don't overload, for instance, for people who want to go into social media. There are a few actually very important things to consider. First of all, negative feedback. If you're gonna blast the message thousands and millions, you're gonna get this very negative. Yeah. It's like, you know, people love it, either love you or either hate you. Yeah. Or if they don't do anything, you're not doing anything, you know? So literally, this is as that. So one is actually, so this negative. The second one is working too hard on this perfect message, yeah?
Yeah.
And then like, oh, they're like, you know, perfectionist. Oh, this is gonna, you know, this gonna, it should be this and this and this, and it's not ready, and that's the reason I'm not pushing it, mm-hmm. yeah? Just start with this imperfection, you know, because what you need to get the first feedback. And then you adjust, then you actually compose the message based on the feedback. So it even gets even more attention and more value.
Yeah, how do you deal with the negative feedback on social media? Because some people, they would like to know how to deal with it because they just don't know how to deal with the negative feedback. How do you deal with it in order to make your company so successful?
Very easy. You take it easy. then you just laugh, you know, like because now we automate a lot, you know. As an agency, we have a lot of clients, so it's barely impossible to just to keep the track. So that's. But on the people's level, yeah, when you're actually reading all these comments, yeah, you just disregard the other one. But I remember when I started my Instagram page, and then I got like you like a comment. You are the ugliest girl I saw this year, and I said, I'm so proud, I'm the one.
Good.
Answered. Good, very good. You know, if he actually made an effort to say, like, okay, in this year, you've made my day, man. Come on.
Just dealing with the negative in in a positive way.
There you go.
Absolutely. You just never go into this negative trap, you know, because it is kind of, it's you can ever be kind of influenced by negativity or positivity. You know, negativity never gets you anywhere. Yeah. But on this positive loop, you just, you know, you keep jumping. So it's like, it's much more productive just
that.
On the efficiency level.
Yeah, so we see social media and things online that it changes all the time. So what, I don't know, I guess being an expert, looking forward, what do you see is going to be the latest things in business and online presence and things like that we should keep our eyes out for?
Oh, that's a very interesting question. It's raised by you would be intrigued, but this question is asked like day by day by
people want to know.
Yeah, people in the know. The yeah. So. The next, well, someone, a lot of, there was a lot of talk that Snapchat is gonna dominate the world, but again, it's now influenced, not influenced, but now it's proven that it's only for the young people, so there is not so much hype. But the general tendency will be, I believe, in for agencies, it's most certainly automation, you know, when you actually can growth hack. So, you know, reducing this span between zero and actually millions and millions of followers, subscribers, So this is, people will get smarter, So with these social channels. What is exciting really is the opportunity for artists, musicians, you know, all the self-publishers, authors, you know, when actually they will start... because the middleman is missing, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The middleman keeps... The smarter the technology, the more people are aware of the social media power, The middleman is kind of... So it's changing the world, So if you can imagine that a person can influence... It's again about the... public opinions, A person can produce a video, a YouTube video, and the next day it's watched by 20 millions.
Yeah.
And this is like, it's a power of launching the products, Again, there is a famous YouTuber who just sold the company to a massive giant. I believe it was Amazon or something. And that was through the power of his videos. Because big brands realize, okay, there are influencers like that, so that they can shape, you know. If the influencer says something, they already have the audiences. So that's massive,
Definitely.
Really interesting. I'm sure it's been helpful to all you ladies.
Thank you
very much, Maria, for coming on and enlightening us on this amazing topic. So we're going to take a short break, but don't go away as we'll be back with more on the topic. Welcome back to today's show, Meet the Bloggers. Ladies, I must say, before the break, what Maria was talking about was really interesting. I really do agree with some of the points. But I want to ask you guys, from your point of view, what do you think, how do you think the social media is played out nowadays, you know, and how it can be a great impact as well as a negative impact, and how people can start seeing it in a different way and use it to a positive advantage?
I think it definitely has can influence, but something that I got from the conversations that we were having is that a lot of the time what you see on social media unfortunately isn't real. And I think that when I think about it, the more that we talk about it, I think a lot of people are influenced by what they see on social media, by what people are doing, by the lifestyles that they think they're living, you know. And I even know of a case of a lady, for instance. She's having a relationship with someone on social media, and I'm a little bit of a detective, so I've actually personally looked up this person. I've realised that he's a scammer, and, you know, he's one of those people trying to, you know, take people for their life savings. You know, you hear about these stories, and she's convinced that he's real and that he's going to come and visit her from wherever he is now. I can't remember what area of the world he's in. So for the past 2 years, she's had this fake relationship with somebody online who she's never met, and she's planning her wedding and so on. And it's actually really scary because she's got all of her hopes and dreams pinned on this person that keeps saying to her, like, you know, for the past 4 or 5 times, oh, I'm coming to England. Oh, no, my flight got cancelled. Oh, no, my son got sick. Oh, no, there's always an excuse of why he can't come. And it's unfortunate because you see that people give their money away to these people because they think that they're real. And, you know, it could just be somebody who's got many online relationships getting money from different people. Mm. And you hear people giving their life savings away, then realising that they've been defrauded. So these are all the negative things. And sometimes what you see on social media is just not real at all. You think it's real, you believe it's real, but it's not. And it goes down to, like, what we were saying about the 16 to 24-year-olds and even other generations. You know, people are going by what they see, and sometimes you see that someone travels a lot or someone has this wonderful lifestyle. You know, this girl, she's always able to afford the best, and she's always eating out, and she's, you know, snapping her lifestyle, and she's Instagramming her food. And it makes you feel really inadequate. Like, oh, I don't have that life, or I can't afford this. And people, sometimes they want to chase that life in the wrong way, and maybe they can turn to crime. Or I know that there was a trend recently where a lot of young girls, they go with older men, for instance, like sugar daddies, to try to fund this lifestyle that they see on social media. Mm. And none of that is real. And how long is this going to last? Mm. So those are all of the negative false effects of social media.
Yeah, that reminds me of a case that I heard about a few years ago where this woman had actually two cases. I'll just mention the one where she had this woman who's unemployed, single mother on income support, and she'd gone off abroad, had this wonderful wedding, came back and posted all her pictures with her husband and, you know, her family on social media. Forgot that she was claiming benefits as a single mother. But then it goes back to what Gemma has just said. People are so keen to present themselves as having this wonderful lifestyle, you know, just following the trend of what's not real for the majority of people.
Yeah. And see, all of her followers probably thought, wow, she's amazing. Like, she's got this fabulous wedding. She's on holiday. She might be on holiday all the time. But, you know, in her day-to-day life, she's actually claiming from the government. Yeah. You know, and that's the thing. It's not always real. A lot of the time on media, things are amplified and you only see the best parts of people's life. And sometimes you're following this and thinking, oh, this is great, this is great. And you let that influence you so much that you can change. Like a lot, like when Anne said about relationship goals and things like that, you see hashtag goals, hashtag eyebrow goals, hashtag relationship goals. And sometimes it's like, if you had that relationship, you'd be unhappy as whatever. Because sometimes they're like kissing and smiling and they don't even get along.
And also, also in England, we have a lot of people who are suffering from depression.
Yeah.
And I guess people look at these social media sites and think, you know, I can't have this lifestyle, you know. And that's not helping them because you see, you see the majority of people are having this wonderful life, you know, going off on holidays and living in nice houses and sailing the Atlantic Ocean on beautiful yachts. And you're thinking, well, I'm here and I can't afford it. But in reality, that's not happening. Yeah. They're not doing that. They're just posting pictures.
Exactly. I do definitely think with social media, there's you have to be able to say, I am who I am.
Yeah.
I live how I live. I'm happy with how I am. Mm. I loved what Maria was saying before when we spoke to her, when someone put a negative comment about her, you're the ugliest person I've seen all year. Yeah. And her response for me was amazing.
Yeah.
And for me, that shows someone whose mind is above.
She's got the strength, but some people do not have the strength to come back and with a positive reply. Mm. You know, she's got the ability and the strength to come back and say, hey, you know, you may look at me as being ugly, but, you know, hey, this is your opinion. Let's move on.
Yeah.
You know, but some people take it to heart. Mm. And then they dwell on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get the suicidal thoughts. You get people actually attempting suicide. Mm. You get all sorts of negativity is coming out of it.
You know how when we watch movies, people know that films and movies are not real, right? And it's the same with social media. Not everything is real. Obviously, you will find some things that are real, but just like the movie is not real, so some things in social media are not real.
Some people can't make that.
And it's something that people
Some people know it, but they still want it. They still, they still desire it. So, I really think social media is a good thing, but it is what you make it, to be honest. It really is what you make it. Like I was saying,
survival of the fittest. Let's face it, survival of the fittest. If you're strong-minded, you go on there and do your thing. If you feel that you're weak-minded, don't do it.
You know, I think as well, talking about like mental stability, I think it's difficult. Social media is a difficult place if you've got issues, like mental issues or any insecurities or emotional issues that you haven't dealt with. Because, for example, even something as simple as putting a photo up that gets no likes.
Yeah, that is true.
Oh, gosh, the power of the likes, eh?
No one likes you. That's what you feel. Yeah. Oh, no
that's
one
a
likes
bad
me.
Day right there for some people.
And then if you've got low self-esteem, that's not going to help
you. No one likes me.
Yeah.
You know, no one likes what I'm doing. I'm boring. And that's where these thoughts come from. Exactly. So sometimes people are really consumed by their social media and what the opinions are out there of them. And if you can't take that, and if you feel like, wow, this is consuming me, it's consuming my time. Oh, no one likes it. No one's commented and you're checking all the time. Then, actually, this might have gotten a little bit too far.
Yeah.
Because, a lot of people, because I really like social media, but I am so focused on making sure that I've actually got something going on in my life rather than just having something to post about. But if it's the opposite, I think that's when it can get dangerous. Like if you're just on in the virtual world, but you're not taking care of your family or you're not interacting with your loved ones because you're always on social media. Like there's some people, they're so great on social media, but nobody knows them. They've got actually no physical friends. Their family would say, well, we never see them. They're locked in their room. They have no actual relationships apart from the virtual ones. Then it's a little bit like, okay, something's not right here. Or sometimes you see like, you're at a dinner table, and I do it a lot with my friends. We're at a dinner table and everyone's on their phone, and then we laugh and we're like, no, let's put the phone down. Because we need to talk. And those are the downsides of it, is when everybody is on their phone. Like I know my mum said recently, no mobile phones at Sunday dinner, because it just takes away from living sometimes. Yeah. And sometimes
it really is.
And it takes away from the living. Sometimes you're so focused on, how many likes and who's checked this and who's done that you're not actually taking advantage of the here and now and who's here right now, who's talking to you right now.
Yeah.
So that's the sad points,
And it's a window to allowing some people to live a double life.
Yeah.
Because I heard recently of somebody who was supposedly training as a barrister. And then when I looked at her social media page, I came back and I said, no way. It's impossible.
Yeah.
She's half naked on her page and doing all sorts of indecent poses. And I said, well, no, there's no way.
Yeah.
She can be training as a barrister, impossible. Yeah. So it kind of gives people
an insight
into who you really are.
But I do think that when all is said and done, we have to admit that overall social media is a positive thing. I mean, speaking purely as a businesswoman, there's many things that I wouldn't have been able to do, many platforms and people that I wouldn't have been able to reach without social media. If we think about LinkedIn, that is amazing.
Yeah.
A lot of people have been given opportunities with LinkedIn, being able to reach platforms without money, etc. So I think, even though there are many negatives and we hear about them a lot more, but there are definitely positives. It's just about what you choose to use and how you use it.
Yeah, agree. I think definitely if you decide this is how my profile is going to be, even if you do get negative feedback, then it's easier for you to say, actually, I've been genuine, I've been true to myself.
Yeah.
And it's okay for people to be negative. In the real world, people are negative as well, but you have to decide what you want your profile to be, and I think be authentic and stick to that, and I think you'll be fine.
Definitely.
Totally agree, ladies. So on that note, as with most things in life, there are positive and negative sides to social networking, and both of which we have explored. My ultimate belief is that when done in moderation, with checks and balances on how younger people in particular are using them, and with a firm grasp being kept on reality at all times, social networking sites doesn't have to be so bad.
Tell us your thoughts on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, or by emailing us on comments@dkw.me. On that note, it's goodbye from us. Until next time. This program.